It's my pleasure to introduce our morning speaker, Dr. Andrew Fletcher. Dr. Fletcher is our Medical Director of Consultative Services, a board-certified anatomic and clinical pathologist, and a certified physician executive. He has significant experience in leading quality across an organization and reducing clinical variation and driving safety and value. Today, he will share with us his extensive knowledge in creating and establishing a lab formulary that makes physicians' jobs easier. Dr. Fletcher?
Hey, good morning. Hey. I really appreciate everybody coming this morning. This is a big show, and so I know there's a lot of things going on, so I appreciate you coming to spend some time this morning. So I'm Dr. Andrew Fletcher, and you know, I start every presentation by telling everybody I was born in Sydney, Australia. So I grew up in the downtown city, I mean, Skyride, you name it, everything. And then at 15, I moved to South Georgia. So I got this weird Australian Southern thing going on. And I'm sorry, everybody asks, where the heck is he from? So in any case, I'm a pathologist, and I'm actually a cytopathologist. So I graduated from my fellowship program, and I was recruited to Tennessee. And in Tennessee, I was minding my own business, signing out pap smears, living the dream. And in 2011, one of my partners came to me and he said, you know what, we're about to have to renegotiate our hospital contract, and we don't want to take a hit on our medical director fees. We're not going to come out with more money, but we don't want to come out with less. Congratulations, you're now in charge of laboratory utilization. And I was like, well, thanks. It's what they call being voluntold. So in any case, in 2011, I started a laboratory utilization committee, and very quickly, we hit on this idea of we need to have a reference laboratory formulary. Now, real quickly, how do we get into this situation? The first thing we addressed in the reference laboratory world was consolidation. So this might not be a problem where you are. It was a problem for us, but we had physicians sending out reference tests to wherever the heck they wanted to. And I used to ask them, so why are you sending this reference test to Laboratory X? And usually the answer was, well, that's where I did my training. I know that's my buddy Bob, or whatever it is. And so we'd send it there and spend 10 times more than what we could have sent to our primary reference lab. So we got a handle on that pretty quickly. We reduced the number of reference labs we were using. And we won't get into that. It's a little bit of a different topic than this morning. But very quickly, we consolidated, and we were doing well with reference laboratory utilization. So we were feeling pretty good, like we got this under control. And then the next thing that happened was this thing called the EMR. So this was back in about 2012. You know, just life was going on as usual. Laboratory was running pretty smoothly. Then one day, the reference labs went through the roof. And we're all sitting there going, what the heck just happened? Well, what happened was the night before, they turned on our EMR. And now, you're not going to believe this, but how did they populate the order entry menu in the EMR? They took their entire LIS database and dumped it into the EMR. And it's like, what just happened? Well, what just happened is physicians now had access to over 1,000 esoteric reference tests at the click of a button. And boy, did they click the buttons. So we're sitting there in our lab utilization committee. I'm thinking, well, what are we going to do? And I was like, you know what? I'm going to come up with a reference test formulary. So I took out a legal pad of paper. I went and sat down, pulled out a pen. And after about 10 seconds, I said, forget this. I mean, really, how many reference tests are there? Which ones do you put in a formulary? So what we decided to do was approach this from the back end. So the first thing we did when coming up with a reference test formulary is we simply said, well, what's in the EMR? Well, what was in the EMR was about 1,200 esoteric reference tests across our system. So we said, well, let's take a look at that. And the first point here is, what have we actually done in the last calendar year? And of the 1,200, we'd only done about 800 reference tests. So just for now, here's the theoretical exercise. Let's delete the other 400. So now let's look at the 800 that we've actually sent out. The next step we did, and we just picked four, and we could have picked two or six, but we said, what if the number is four? What if we haven't sent this test out more than four times a year or once per quarter? Well, that's a kind of unusual test, so let's delete those as well. So we went from 800 to about 400. So now we've got the 400 tests, which people are actually interested in ordering with any sort of volume. Okay, now the next point is, just because we sent them out a lot, maybe they weren't the right test. We were an ARUP client, so we have been getting these things called ATOP reports, analysis of test ordering patterns. And basically, it was a list we got every year that showed us all the funny tests we'd ordered. And I'll be honest with you, every year we put it aside. And then the next year, they give us the same report. So what we did is we went through 5 years of those reports and said, just because we sent a test a lot, maybe it's not the right test. So here's a test, and you guys are going to love this one, RBC folate. Just because we sent it out 77 times doesn't mean we're going to send it out and delete it. What about factor 5 Leiden? Let's delete that and replace it with APC resistance with reflex to factor 5 Leiden. That list of 400 went down to about 200. The actual list was 176 tests where I was. Now, interestingly, in my current role as medical director of consultative services traveling around the country, all of the hospitals I've seen go through this exercise end up with around 200 tests. I don't know what it is. It just seems to be the magic number. So in any case, here we are. We've got our list of 176 tests. We've taken out all those goofy tests that people really shouldn't be ordering, and we've cleaned up the menu. The next thing we did, which is really interesting, and you guys are going to look at this and go, How are they being listed in the EMR? Because what we came to find is, in every single case, the incorrect test is listed first, because as you can see with the vitamin D example, 125 comes before 25, because a computer says 1 comes before 2. And so in each of these cases, you can see that the preferential test is listed second or third. It's not the first test. Now, talking to physicians and nurses, when they see this pop up, was it 125 or 25? I don't know. Click. Or click, click, because the lab will figure it out. No, we're not going to figure it out. We're going to do exactly what you're ordering. So what we like to do is make sure of those 176 tests, make sure they're tweaked in the EMR so they're being presented in the correct sequence. As I had mentioned, we ended up deleting RBC folate. We actually deleted 125 dihydroxy on the inpatient side because none of our nephrologists or endocrinologists had ordered it on the inpatients. The only people ordering it were hospitalists, family practitioners, folks who probably didn't really need the test. So at this point, we've got 176 tests. They're all tweaked to be in the correct order. And I'm sitting there, and all of a sudden I realize 10% of my reference tests are being ordered from the emergency room. I'm like, what the heck is going on in the emergency room? And so we were conveniently located in the basement below the emergency room. I'm sure we're the only laboratory that was in the basement. So I went marching up the stairs to the emergency room. I go busting in there. And I found the department chair of emergency medicine. I said, what the heck? You guys are ordering 10% of my reference tests. What are you thinking? And he looks at me and he says, what's a reference test? At which point I went marching back down the stairs to my office. I said, I'm not doing that again. But in any case, I got to looking at it. I thought, well, they don't know what a reference test is. But you know what? I'm not sure I know what a reference test is. I mean, it's a big laboratory. I don't know what we do versus what we send out. And then, you know, here's another number. I've learned this since I started ARUP. 41% of all of the inpatient reference testing that we receive is reported post-discharge. And you look at that and, gosh, 41% of these tests aren't coming back until the patient's discharged. Now, I get it. There's some meconium drug studies, drug screens, some COAG, infectious disease. But even if you take that out, of the 41%, about half of that appears to be reference testing that has no relationship to the hospital inpatient stay, and they're being reported post-discharge. Talking to a hospitalist, guess what? Same question. Well, we don't know what a reference test is. How are we supposed to address that? So we have 176 reference tests. They're all tweaked in the correct order. The next thing we did is we gave them some information. So you can see in this example, we'll just pick one here for renin. Embedded into the EMR, renin, parentheses, ref, reference, comma, dollar, dollar. Now, we happened to pick dollar signs. We just thought it was a convenient way to do it. Some places pick real numbers. We thought that's a little bit hard to maintain. We just want to give the doctor a sense of roughly how much does this thing cost. And so each dollar sign is a $50 increment from the costing tool. We thought that would just be a simple way to do it. From the physician's perspective, the next piece I think is critical. So in this case, you can see that one's 2D, but you can see there's some 3Ds. Guess what? That's your turnaround time. Now, this is embedded in the name in the EMR. No more physician clicks, no best practice alerts. You don't have to go look for it. It's right there. Nobody has to stop and get out of the EMR. So it's very convenient for physicians. Okay, so now we've got 176 tests. They're all tweaked the correct order. We're telling them it's a reference test, kind of how expensive it is and the turnaround time. Now, before we went live with this, obviously we have to let physicians know, hey, we're going to be deleting a lot of tests here. So we went to go talk to the ologists, you know, those guys, the hematologists, infectious diseaseologists or whatever they are. In any case, we told them, we said, listen, you guys sometimes have to order weird tests. We get it. Pretty soon, that list is going to be really short. You won't have to go searching through it. We're going to build a free text laboratory function. You just tell us what you want to order. And you know, the physicians really appreciated that, because what they told me is, you know what, I'm sick of scrolling through over 1,000 tests to find the test I want. I can't find it. Then I have to call the laboratory, and it's just a mess. So it's like, okay, perfect. Now, just tell us what you want, and we'll order it. Anecdotal information, I don't have any evidence to base this, but I'll just say in my own experience, if a physician can coherently type the name of a test, that's the first step right there. At least they know what they're ordering. If you get that weird request for, let me think of a real example, flow cytology. Okay, I'm going to give that physician a call. He doesn't know what he's ordering. What we found out is that free text lab command, we actually put a canned comment saying, please tell us the test you request. If unsure, please put your cell phone number and we will contact you. It was a nice way for physicians actually to put in a curbside consult to the laboratory to help us order the correct test. Now, here's a real key point, because somebody's probably sitting here thinking, I am not going to increase my miscellaneous reference test. That is going to drive us crazy. So a very important part here is, don't delete any of these tests from the LIS. The deletion part is on the physician side in the EMR. So we're hiding tests in the EMR, but not the LIS. So that way, when you get a miscellaneous reference test request, you can go ahead and place the order without doing a miscellaneous. Okay, so everything's in place, and this was back about probably 2013. And so one night in Tennessee, about, I think it was a Tuesday at midnight, because that's when things happen in EMRs and LIS systems. They always do it at midnight. So I came to work the next morning. And if you can imagine this, the night before, we deleted 1,000 reference tests in the EMR. I had actually called the physician call center and said, you guys better ramp up on your staffing, because tomorrow might be a rough day. You know how many physicians called the next morning? A real round number. Zero. Not one. In fact, the call center called me, and they said, what happened? I thought last night the big change was happening. I said, it did. Not a single phone call. And, you know, I was like, gosh, nobody noticed we just deleted 1,000 reference tests? So in any case, some time went by, and I guess about a week later, I went to go find our chief of staff, and he's a surgeon. I love surgeons. But in any case, this guy, very plain spoken, it's hard to believe, being a surgeon. And so I asked him, I said, what do you think about what we did in the EMR? He looked at me, he said, that's the only good blanking thing that anybody ever did in that blanking EMR since the blanking thing was turned on. I was like, well, okay, so there you go. What we found is physicians really liked it. All of a sudden, as I mentioned before, they don't have to go searching for the tests. Here's the tests that they wanted to order, and it was right there in front of them. Matter of fact, it was so successful, what we ended up doing was applying the same rule to pharmacy. Now, in pharmacy, obviously, they don't have reference pharmaceuticals, but they do have things which are formulary and non-formulary. And in addition, their dollar signs are on a completely different scale, but same principle. So what happened in the healthcare system? As far as financials, prior to the implementation, we were sending out about $31,000 a month on the inpatient reference side. Now, what's important about it is the inpatient is, of course, reimbursed via DRG. So this is pure cost to the hospital. These are real dollars. After the implementation of the new formulary, it went to about $20,000, which is a 35% decrease. In this one hospital, we projected about $132,000 for the year. It turned out to be $141,000. So this is, I think, a very effective way to implement a formulary. Now, people have asked me, they said, that's wonderful. Could you please share your formulary with us? And, you know, I'd be happy to do it, but what I came to find is my formulary won't work for your hospital because your physicians are different to mine. It might be close. I don't think what's important, though, is sharing the actual formulary. It's sharing the technique of how to develop that. Because, really, I've never seen two hospitals that had the same formulary. The system where I was, we had 14 hospitals, everything from a level one trauma center down to a two-bed critical care hospital. Now, I can tell you what the formulary looked like for the two-bed critical care hospital. There wasn't a formulary. They never sent out reference testing. So I think that's where it's important to take that process and apply it to your own healthcare system or hospitals. You know, as far as formulas, here at ARUP, we spend a lot of time looking at the tests people send us, and we tend to focus a lot on the high-volume, high-cost tests, which makes perfect sense. What I like to do, though, is go look. A lot of our clients, 50% of the volume we're receiving, they're the onesies and the twosies. It's the test that is sent to us once or twice a year. And when we look and see, take a look at them, again, 41% are inpatient. Now, again, not all of them are unnecessary, but I think it's a symptom of formularies can help eliminate some of those low-volume but high-cost tests. So in any case, at this point, there's a quick presentation. I promise we go for about 15 to 20 minutes. Do we have any questions about test formularies? I will say why you're here. This experience of adding the dollar signs, the reference test identification, and the turnaround time ultimately led to us partnering with a company called Illumicare to develop an Illumicare ribbon where we can provide this directly in the hospital's EMRs. And this was the catalyst for that, because we really feel like giving physicians that information seamlessly in the EMR is important. So if after our talk today you're interested, we can show you some demos of how ARUP does this for our clients. And it's been very successful so far. So unless there's any questions, we'll turn it back over to Sandy.